When it comes to historic Sony devices, the Walkman gets all the attention, but the TR-55 has to be the most important device in the company's history. It sparked a revolution in radio and gave the company the financial clout to come up with Trinitron, the Walkman of course, the 3.5-inch floppy, MiniDisc, the PlayStation, Blu-ray, and Betamax. Some of them were, of course, more successful than others. So just why was the TR-55 such a revolution? Let's find out. In the 1920s, radio was a gadget everyone had to have. For very little, you could get the latest news and entertainment beamed into your home for nothing. Books were replaced with dramas with the finest actors, and Aunt Ethel's piano playing was replaced with symphony orchestras with quality better than phonographs. Companies such as the Radio Corporation of America, or RCA, went from strength to strength. The first radios were crystal sets. They were cheap, and in fact you can actually make one yourself, but could only be listened to through earphones and had a limited range. Vacuum tube radios in the 1920s could receive stations from further away and could be heard through a loudspeaker, but the vacuum tube was relatively expensive, fragile, and was prone to break over time. Until the 1950s, that was about as good as it got for radios. There were minor improvements to prevent fading stations and fluctuating volume, but radios remained large things that needed to be plugged in or that required hefty batteries. In 1947, AT&T's Bell Labs invented the transistor, and they developed a prototype transistor radio the following year after they got patent protection. But moving from the lab to production proved difficult. Only one out of every 20 transistors they made actually worked, so they allowed it to be licensed to all comers in the hope someone would create something practical. Texas Instruments were a company that specialized in seismographs for oil exploration, but they had dreams of becoming so much more. They saw the opportunity to make a practical transistor and worked with Industrial Development Engineering Associates, or IDEA, to manufacture a practical transistor radio, the Regency TR-1 in 1954. But the cost of the transistor was a major sticking point. It cost Texas Instruments around $10 to $15 to make each transistor, and there were about six in the circuit. The goal was to sell the new radio for $50, the same price as a good quality portable valve radio, and it doesn't take a mathematician to realize that this wasn't going to make a profit. Undeterred, the radio was cost reduced down to four transistors, but this severely reduced audio output volume. And Texas Instruments sold all four transistors to IDEA at a loss, just $10 for all four of them. The hope was once they hit volume, the manufacturing cost would come down and they would be able to make a profit. The Regency TR-1 was initially a hit with customers, but magazines such as Consumer Reports reported the high level of noise and instability on certain radio frequencies and recommended against buying one. Japan's economy was on its knees after the Second World War. Masaru Ibuka started a radio repair business in a bomb-damaged shop in Tokyo. Soon his company, known colloquially as Totsuko, produced Japan's first tape recorder, the Type G. Ibuka travelled to the USA in the early 1950s to market Totsuko's new device and heard about the transistor. With the help of his partner, Akio Morito, whose family had a successful sake business that invested in Totsuko, he became one of the licensees of the Bell Labs patent. Bell Labs suggested they use it to make hearing aids, but there was no market for that. Both men settled on the idea of creating a transistor radio. It seemed an unsurmountable challenge for such a small company when large American corporations were struggling to productize transistors. They needed to put lots of skilled people on the job, build their own production machinery, and work out how to actually make a transistor. The money required meant this small company was betting their entire existence on all of this actually working. It would take until 1954 to create their first working transistor. By January 1955, they produced a transistor that could produce sound and a radio circuit that used only 5 transistors. Now they needed all the other parts for this tiny radio, an electronic device much smaller than those before it. This meant persuading manufacturers of speakers, volume controls, and switches to produce smaller versions. The hope was this new product would be sold in North America and Europe, so it needed a suitably Western-friendly product name. The company chose the name Sony, a name derived from the Latin word for sound, sonus, and sunny, slang for a young boy, and referenced the fact that this product came from a young company. The first product was a pocket radio similar to the Regency TR-1, dubbed the Sony TR-52. On a sales trip to the USA, they got an order for 100,000 units from watch company Bulova. But Bulova wanted to rebrand it with their own name, given that no one in America had heard of Sony. Bulova had a strong brand with more than 50 years of history behind it. This led Akio Morito to utter these prophetic words: "In 50 years' time, we will have made the name Sony as famous as yours." As Sony was about to release their transistor radio, disaster struck. In hot spring temperatures, the front lattice peeled away from the black backing on all 100 samples. They were forced to call off the public launch. To make matters worse, other companies started releasing transistor radios, the Raytheon 8TP1 and the General Electric 675. Sony wouldn't make the same mistake again, though. They made sure that their next radio would use a durable yet attractive material. Just 3 months later, they launched the Sony TR-55, Japan's first transistor radio. It was powered by 4 small AA batteries, and the simple circuit was laid out on a printed circuit board, still a relatively new concept. The controls are also familiar to modern eyes, a rotary tuning control and a volume knob that doubled as the on-off switch. Around the back was a flap for the earphone socket. It set the prototype for inexpensive consumer electronics that would become a Japanese staple, and Sony would go on to reap the rewards. Sony's new radio sold for more than the Regency, around $70 in 1955, but it made a profit, and Sony knew that although many transistors failed during production, that would improve and production costs would come down. A kit radio, the TR-2, launched that same year for just 1/3 the price. 2 years later, Sony exported the pocket-sized TR-63 around the world, that is if you had large pockets. With maybe 1 radio per household, the market for inexpensive personal radios was vast. Transistors were the future and Sony was the leader of the pack. Car radios were now practical, home radios could be smaller and cheaper, TVs could be made for less. Sony went from strength to strength. Texas Instruments might have failed to capture the radio market, but their focus on producing transistors paid off. They would come to dominate the market, and would then move into producing silicon chips with similar success. 50 years after Sony launched their transistor radio, Akio Morita's prophetic words came true. The Sony name was not just as well known as Bulova, it was one of the best known brands in the world. Today, Sony still makes radios. You can buy the ICV-506, maybe the spiritual successor to the TR-55, and there's a pocket-sized model for half the price. But all of Sony's success over all these years all began with the transistor and the TR-55. Another company that came to dominate the industry was Tonka, maker of the indestructible truck. See a video with their story on the right. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.